So a couple of years ago, I got the opportunity to set up my own group. And after working on tunneling for about 10 years, I was considering it a fairly trivial quantum effect. So I thought I would go looking for something that was a lot weirder. So I'm a biophysicist, which means I know only enough physics to be dangerous and just enough biology to be quite skeptical. So basically, whenever I try to do something, there's always got to be an experimental test. And this is very much a work in progress, but I'm going to tell you about what we're trying to do to look for some weirdness in the way that enzymes select their substrates. So this was kind of came about almost a perfect storm. So there's a big systems biology presence in Manchester, and they have a very holistic view of how we should be dealing with biological processes. So rather than looking at an enzyme and a reaction, they're sort of looking for the way that the whole system operates. So whether you get sort of almost an order out of chaos. And this is quite different to the way that we do this sort of reaction in a more classical enzymology lab, where we have a purified enzyme in a reaction with our substrate, or sometimes in an inhibition experiment, we might have a single inhibitor working against the substrate. If you look at biology, this is the glycolytic pathway, and I'm not going to dwell on it, but basically this is the way that that we break down glucose into smaller molecules whilst generating various useful things along the way. But basically the point is that as you go along, you have all of these substrates and products which look quite similar to each other, and yet there's a separate enzyme catalyzes more or less each of these steps. And in addition to being able to enhance the rate of this reaction over the uncatalyzed rate by phenomenal amounts, these enzymes are all very good at choosing the right substrate, or at least we think they are, because whenever we've done these sorts of experiments, they show exquisite selectivity. But people don't tend to do experiments in test tubes where they throw everything in the chemical cabinet in with their enzyme and see what happens. And so I think there's still an open question about quite whether the way enzymes select their substrates is purely a blind search, whether it's purely governed by thermodynamics, or whether maybe there's some magic involved. And so the perfect storm also came about when I started reading papers from the quantum information guys. This is just to point out. So at the moment, there's about 20 or 30,000 proteins in humans. Not all of them encode enzymes. But there's at least 8,000 metabolites known, and this is a number that's still growing. So there's an awful lot of things to get in the way. Reading the literature from some of the quantum information guys, I started wondering about whether enzymes could be spooky, basically, whether we could use some sort of quantum mechanical quirk to basically aid the way that an enzyme selects its substrate. So rather than having a purely blind search, whether there could be something that would enhance the ability to choose the right substrates. So Patel was very much an advocate of this about 10 years or so, and he invoked Grover's algorithm as probably more of a metaphor than a reality for the way that DNA polymerase may select the correct nucleotides during DNA replication. And when I read this, I thought, wow, this is a really neat idea. And then the biologist in me said, well, that's ridiculous. How can you have, these algorithms involve entanglement and superposition of quite big molecules. So, at least substrates and potentially part of your enzyme. But I did some reading, and I came across a few experiments. But being the biologist, this is basically the way that I try to determine whether or not I should be paying attention to quantum mechanics. So this is the Broglie wavelength. So I started out working on electrons. They've got wavelengths in the region of nanometers. Then I moved to Manchester and worked with Nigel, started working on hydrogen and deuterium. you're down to sub-angstrom wavelengths, but in the order of a bond length, that's still important. You get up to substrates and proteins. These things are big. So your average substrate is in the region of, it can be up to 1,000 Daltons or atomic mass units, whichever language you speak. They can be bigger. Proteins can be truly monstrous. So the smallest ones are in the region of, you know, tens of kilodaltons, and they can get into the many megadaltons. And so up at this end, you're clearly, you know, the amount of quantum mechanical behavior you're going to expect out of these guys at anything like room temperature is pretty marginal, at least in this sort of framework. But there might be some wiggle room. And, you know, physicists can do some pretty neat experiments which kind of make me question all sorts of things. So this is one of my favorite experiments. This is a double slit experiment with buckyballs. And when I first saw this, I thought, wow, this is pretty neat. But it was only when I came back a couple of years ago and looked at this again that I realized that they did this at 900 Kelvin. So everything I know about quantum mechanics says that this shouldn't have the faintest hint of quantum character, yet it does a double slit experiment. It behaves at least a little bit like a wave. So the Broglie wavelength of this thing should be buried right in the middle of it. You might understand what's going on here, I don't. But basically, it gave me hope, because this thing's bigger than your average substrate. So if this thing can at least have a small hint of quantum character at 900 Kelvin, maybe my substrates can as well at room temperature. So
I think you said that's coherence between many C60 molecules rather than quantum effects within each one.
Sure. So this is what we need. What we need for quantum selection is some way for the enzyme to be able to, or for multiple substrates to be able to talk to each other in the vicinity of the enzyme. And for one of them, the correct one, to end up with its wave function collapsed in the active site of the enzyme. Whether it uses Grover's algorithm or whatever, I'm treating it purely as a black box. I don't want to really know what the quantum mechanics is at this stage. I'm just looking for evidence for something out of the order, or beyond what we would expect from semi-classical behavior. So this is exactly what we do with proton tunneling reactions. It's a good way to go looking for quantum mechanics. So we know what the semi-classical behavior is. We can model these as a series of ordinary differential equations. We can calculate more or less what we would expect to happen if you threw multiple competing substrates or inhibitors in with the reaction. And we can calculate what would happen, or model what would happen, if you turned on quantum mechanics. And basically, you're going to get something like an exponential speed up. So much like a quantum search algorithm, if you had quantum selection of substrates, you would expect, as you threw more and more competing substrates in with your enzyme, you'd expect the reaction relative to a non-quantum mechanical system to go much faster or more efficiently. So that's basically the theory behind it. I'm sorry it's quite woolly, but that's why I come to meetings like this, to find out how to do this bit. But I'm going to talk a little bit about how we're going to try to test this. And as I said, it's a work in progress, so we don't have any real answers yet. But we've almost got to the point now where we can ask the question properly, and that's, you know, often a big step. So I mentioned earlier that it was Patel suggested that Grover's algorithm might be at least a metaphor for the way that DNA replication happens. So DNA replication is a horrendously complicated reaction in the cell. But biologists do it all the time in small Eppendorf tubes, and it's basically the PCR reaction. So from a reductionist or a physicist point of view, you can chop out almost all of that complexity, and really all you need is a piece of single-stranded DNA with a primer annealed to it, and you need an enzyme called DNA polymerase. And then you need to add nucleotides or substrates. And as long as you keep the temperature sensible, it will incorporate substrates and create double-stranded DNA. This is a single step of the PCR reaction. Now, this is a pretty impressive reaction, and the reason that I'm working on it, and the reason that Grover suggested it, at least in part, is it's a fairly uncommon example of an enzyme that is designed to work with multiple substrates. So it's a good choice to go after an enzyme that has to work with more than one substrate. Most of them tend to be optimized to work with a single one well. Often they'll work less well with a small suite, but this is one which biology absolutely needs to work more or less perfectly with four of them. So if we hark back to Johnjoe's talk yesterday, the error rate of this enzyme is pretty low. So in the absence of proofreading, which is kind of an elaborate bolt-on way that these enzymes can fix errors, in the absence of all of that, because we're going to chop all that out, we can do that genetically, you make an error approximately one every 10 to the 4, 10 to the 5 times, which is pretty good. And it basically, this error arises due to the ketoenol tautomerization of the bases. And I put an aside in last night. So this is more or less what happens in a prokaryote. It's much more complicated than the way that we're going to do the reaction in our test tube. So there's a number of other enzymes involved, because what you have in biology is double-stranded DNA, and what you need to do is make one double-stranded DNA molecule into two double-stranded DNA molecules. So there's enzymes that unwind it, enzymes that wind it back up again and stop it overwinding, and various other bits and bobs. But we can just basically do away with most of that. But the point is, you do have, at least for a moment, a section of single-stranded DNA. So if you form a keto or an enol tautomer that is the wrong one, it will see solvent for a while. This doesn't happen in the active site of DNA polymerase. I was really captivated by your idea yesterday, and then I started thinking about it. And coming from Manchester, one thing we do know how to do rather well is isotope effects. So if you consider these sorts of reactions, the isotope effect going from the enone to the alcohol might be quite large. So in the absence of proper spooky tunneling, you're still going to have a zero-point energy correction to this. So you're going to expect to see maybe a KIE of about 7. It might be smaller, but it could be a lot larger if tunneling's involved. But the problem is that this is an equilibrium. So this reaction will be quite fast, and it'll be particularly fast relative to the melting of double-stranded DNA into single-stranded DNA. So it's going to go back again. So unless this back reaction is very slow relative to DNA melting, this is going to be an equilibrium. So we don't need to consider the kinetic isotope effect. We need to consider the EIE. It's nothing to do with old McDonald. This is the equilibrium isotope effect. And basically, I would bet, small sums of money, that the isotope effect going in this direction is almost identical to the isotope effect going in this direction. The equilibrium isotope effect is the ratio of these isotope effects. So almost invariably, the EIE is close to unity. So you can grow your E. coli or whatever in D2O. You'll inhibit this reaction, but you'll also inhibit this reaction. The resulting equilibrium won't really change, so I wouldn't predict that you're going to see a big effect, which is a damn shame, because we'd quite like to see some experimental evidence for this stuff. But that was my aside. So we're going to go back to the experiments that we're doing in my lab. So the thing that kind of convinced me that there might be something going on was when I stopped looking at the Watson-Crick base pairing and actually started considering what the substrate, what the DNTP looks like in solution. And most of it is a common molecule. You have a ribose, you have a triphosphate, and then you have your Watson-Crick base hanging off the end of it. And they're clearly different molecules, but a lot of that molecule is shared. So the way that the enzyme is going to have to choose the right one is confounded by the fact that most of the molecule is the same. So whilst I remain deeply skeptical that there's any quantum search going on, it seems like a great system to test. So off we go. We're going to do this reaction in the cell. In a test tube, in the most reduce as many degrees of freedom as we possibly can, and start characterizing it under conditions where we throw competing substrates or inhibitors at it. And that was the idea 2 years ago when I started this project. But I've never worked on the system before, and I didn't quite appreciate how complicated it is. So rather than your typical Michaelis-Menten type model for this reaction, the minimum model involves a few more steps. So you have to bind DNA, and then you have to bind a substrate. There's a conformational change before you actually form your Watson-Crick base pair in the enzyme as well. And this is what also got me thinking that perhaps this quantum search makes a good idea, or makes at least sense, because If you bind the nucleotide, you're probably too far away for that base pairing to initially happen. So the enzyme has to do a relatively slow and inefficient conformational change. It has to shut the lid and ram essentially the base pair into the active site. That's when the chemistry happens and it spits phosphate out and it goes again. So there was also an ulterior motive when I started this project, because there's going to be some wonderful isotope effects to measure, and this is kind of the secondary point of this project, and unfortunately we haven't quite got to those yet either. But basically what we want to do is we want to characterize these reactions and look for quantum selection of substrates and or some sort of fun tunneling in the active site. Now the way that people have done these sorts of... Yeah, okay, this is the last slide. Basically, well, the way we're doing it is we've had to reinvent the wheel. So we're now using fluorescent dyes to quantify double-stranded DNA synthesis. You used to do this with radioisotope effects, but I'm allergic to that sort of paperwork. So we've reinvented the wheel. And 2 years later, we're now at the point where we can ask this question. So the next time we have one of these workshops, I'd like to stand up here and tell you what I've found. So I think I'll leave it at that then. I should thank Max Driscoll and Julius, who's in the audience, for doing a lot of this work, and the BBSRC for funding it. So, and to all of you, thank you.